Thank you, Etienne, for the introduction. I also would like to thank the organizers to give me the opportunity to give a talk here. I have already given several talks in this room, but this is the first time that there are so many people inside, so I think SEMRAX is a big success. My talk will be divided into two parts. I will first introduce the Metropolis testing algorithm on the blackboard. Then I will turn to the optimized scaling part of the talk, which is a joint work with Tony Lelièvre and Blazey Miazogedo. And you will see that there will be some mean field interaction in this part. So what is the Metropolis testing algorithm? It's an algorithm widely used in applied sciences, and it is aimed at the simulation according to some probability measure, pi, which may be written in the following way. So here we have lambda, which is some reference measure on some measurable state space E, and eta is some function from E to R plus, such that the integral is positive and finite. So eta is some unnormalized density with respect to the reference measure lambda. Okay? So one wants to either to sample from pi or to compute expectations of functions integrated against pi. And the example that I have in mind in statistical physics when I will choose E to be R to the N endowed with a Lebesgue measure and eta of X could be E to the minus U of X over KBT, where U is some potential function from Rn to R, KB is the Boltzmann constant, and T the temperature, okay? And this is the so-called Boltzmann-Gibbs measure associated with the potential and temperature T, okay? And there are also examples with finite states in statistical physics, for instance, when you want to deal with spin models, then you can have some finite states, but very, very large state space like this one for large n. And the other main example is statistics, Bayesian statistics, so you will have some parameter of the model, which is theta, which belong to E, and you have some a priori density P theta of theta. And then you have a conditional density of observing y, given that the parameter is theta. And this is denoted in the following way. And according to Bayes' rule, then you can compute the a posteriori density of the parameter once you have observed y. The a posteriori density is simply p theta theta py given theta y theta over the integral. Okay. And one wants to simulate according to this a posteriori density. Okay? And in both cases, the computation of the normalizing constant is a difficult problem. And we will see that the Metropolis Hastings algorithm doesn't need this normalizing constant. So, to construct the algorithm, we need some Markov density kernel Q. Such that, so for any state x, first the integral of q with respect to the second variable is equal to 1. This means that for fixed x as a function of y, this is some probability density with respect to lambda. And the other thing that we need. It is easy to simulate according to this density, or this probability measure. Okay? Then we introduce the so-called Metropolis Hastings acceptance ratio, which will be the minimum between 1 and eta of y, q of yx over eta of x, q of xy, when eta of x, q of xy positive, so when the denominator does not vanish, and we take it equal to wise, to one by convention otherwise. Okay, so now how do we construct some Markov chain which will be targeting pi? In fact, one starts from x naught, some e-valued random variable, and given the trajectory up to time k, we generate some proposal yk plus 1 distributed according to the density taken at xk plus 1. On some uniform random variable on 0, 1, both, of course, independent. And we then set xk plus 1 is equal to this proposal when the uniform random variable is smaller than alpha of xk yk plus 1. And this is some event with probability alpha of xk yk plus 1 because the function alpha is with values between 0 and 1. And so we accept the move with this probability. And otherwise, we stay at the current position. OK. So this way, we will obtain some Markov chain. And now I am going to compute its Markov kernel. So when I want to compute the conditional expectation of f of xk plus 1, where f is some test function given the trajectory up to time k, then it's convenient to use the tower property of the conditional expectation to first condition with respect to the trajectory up to time k plus the proposal yk plus 1. And then, OK. So what's going on now in this conditional expectation? We just average out over the independent uniform on 0, 1 random variable uk plus 1. And we obtain that this is simply f of yk plus 1 alpha xk yk plus 1 plus f of xk 1 minus alpha of xk yk plus 1, okay, given. And when we go to the choice of yk plus 1 now, we finally obtain that this is equal to the integral of f of y q of xk or p of xk dy. So what is p? P is simply the following kernel. So either the proposal is different from the current state, and then you accept the move with a probability alpha of xy. Okay. Or otherwise, you stay at the current position. So you will have the case where you propose something different, z should be different from x, some z different from x, and you don't accept the move. And the case when you propose simply x, which may be important for finite states capital E, then you have when you propose x, you stay at the same position, of course. So this is delta x, Dirac mass at x of dy. Okay, and then the important thing is that you have the following condition, is that eta of x, q of xy, alpha of xy, this will be simply some symmetric function of x and y, okay? Because you take you multiply with this minimum, you obtain the minimum of eta of x, q of xy, eta of y q of y x. And you have a minimum of two symmetric expressions in x and y, and this is a symmetric function of x and y. And of course, this leads to the fact that the indicator function of y different from x, eta of x, lambda of dx, p of x dy, will be equal to eta of x alpha of xy. Maybe I should put the q before, q of xy, alpha of xy, lambda of dx, lambda of dy. And of course, this is, because all this is symmetric, also the same as eta of y, lambda of dy, p of y dx. Okay? So now, of course, this is also true when you work on the indicator of y equal to x, and it remains true when you normalize everything. So we end up with this nice relation, that is that pi is reversible with respect to the kernel y. And one consequence of this reversibility is that pi is invariant with respect to y, because now if we integrate this over the y variable, we obtain over the x, let's say, we obtain that this is simply pi of dy, p of ye, okay? And p of ye is simply 1. Okay, this is a Markov kernel. And of course, this leads to the invariance of pi for the Markov kernel P. And do you have questions at this stage? So if everything is clear, now I will turn to the slides. So I will first give some remarks. Okay, I'm not at the right place. Okay, now I am. So we have made some special choice of the alpha function, in fact. And in fact, the reversibility of pi with respect to p is preserved when we take other functions of the ratio here. We had the special case of the minimum of 1 on the ratio before. And the two conditions that are needed is simply that a of 0 is 0, and f for positive u, f a of u is u times a of 1 over u. Okay? And some other example is simply this function. But the choice that I wrote, this is the so-called Metropolis choice, this is the Barker choice, is better for asymptotic variants of the empirical ergodic mean, according to a paper by Pescun. Of course, this is for the same proposal density Q. It's because, in fact, the choice here maximizes the probability of accepting moves which are real moves with y different from x. And something important for the second part of the talk is to introduce the so-called random walk metropolis testing algorithm. So we choose the density Q of xy as some symmetric probability density of the difference here. And I will consider Gaussian random walks. So here we have the standard normal distribution on Rn with variance or covariance matrix sigma square times the identity. And what's going on now is that there is some simplification in the metropolis testing ratio, because on one end you have on the numerator phi of y minus x, and on the denominator phi of x minus y. And since phi is symmetric, this simplifies out, and you have just the ratio of the unnormalized density. Okay. This is called random wall metropolis testing algorithm. So once one has some constructed some Markov kernel or Markov chains with pi as a reversible measure, then one can go to the ergodic theory for Markov chains and find conditions on the kernel P such that we have the ergodic results. First, the convergence in law of xk to pi as time k goes to infinity. Second, the ergodic theorem, so to compute integrals with respect to pi, it's when the function, of course, is integrable, it's easy to compute this kind of arithmetic average along the path of the Markov chain. Okay? And in good situation, you also have central limit theorems for this convergence. So we have this error term renormalized by the square root of the number of steps in the chain, and it converges in law to some Gaussian distribution centered, and where the asymptotic variance is given by this expression here. In fact, you can check that from Jensen's inequality, this capital F square is larger than the integral here. Or it uses also the invariance of pi. What is capital F? It is the solution to the Poisson equation. Okay, so you solve F minus capital P capital F of X should be equal to small f of X minus the expectation of F according to pi. And why does this solution to the Poisson equation appear in the asymptotic variance? It's not at all the IID case, of course, where only the variance of F according to pi would play a role. Then it's simply that when we look at this sum of errors, and when you use the Poisson equation, then you have some boundary terms, and the important ones is that one, where I rewrote F capital F of xj using the Poisson equation, and this is simply P capital F of xj minus one, which can be interpreted as this conditional expectation. And this is some martingale increment, and in fact, one way to prove the central limit theorem is to use some central limit theorems for martingales. Of course, these remainder terms will vanish when, in fact, this will be divided by 1 over square root of k, and this will vanish. And we have this martingale, which plays a central role. So now I'm going to turn to the second part of my talk. And the question is the following one, and the setting first. So I consider Gaussian random walk metropolis Hastings algorithm in dimension n, and now I put a superscript n because I will let the dimension go to infinity. Okay, so this is the Gaussian density proposal, and we have the simplification of the metropolis Hastings ratio that I mentioned before. And the big question when using some metropolis Hastings algorithm, and in particular when the dimension n grows, is how to choose the variance of a proposal, okay? Because one may have bad exploration of the space and therefore poor ergodic properties of the means that we saw in the last slide, in two opposite situations. The first situation is when sigma is too large, then large moves are proposed, but they are almost always rejected, so you stay very long at the same place and it's not good. Second, if sigma is too small, then a large proportion of the proposed moves is accepted, but then these are very, very small moves, but so you stay also at the same place. So this is not good. So the tuning of the parameter sigma, or the tuning in more generally of the proposal density, is very important to have good ergodic properties. So there was a previous work by Roberts, Gell-Mann, and Giltz, which assumed that the target density is the n-fold product of density corresponding, one-dimensional density corresponding to potential V. So this is this setting here with U of X, which is simply the sum of V of the coordinates of X, okay? So the target is of IID type, and they also assume that the initial condition is distributed according to the target, okay? And this is a very strong assumption, in fact. And then they perform some diffusive scaling, okay? They divide the square root of the variance by square root of n, and then they rescale time by accelerating by the same factor n, and they obtain, of course, this is some diffusive scaling, the same as in Donsker theorem for the convergence of renormalized random walk to the Brownian motion, and it's not surprising to obtain some diffusive limit. Okay? And what they prove is that the first component, this is the index for the first component, converges in distribution to one-dimensional diffusion process, which is this process. Okay, so this process, of course, has the stationary density e to the minus v. It's the calculation that Pierre Degon did on the blackboard yesterday. And this is the overdamped Langevin dynamics associated to this target distribution. But it is accelerated by some function of the constant L that we have here. And of course, to go faster to equilibrium, we should choose h of l as large as possible. So this is the precise definition of function h, where you see that the cumulative distribution function of a normal law appears. Now, what are the practical consequences of this scaling result? What I said is that we should maximize h of l, and this is the expression of the argument of the maximum, okay? And sadly, it still depends on the potential v through this moment of v prime square, okay? But what is very nice is that when one computes the limit of the average acceptance rate, which is the expectation of alpha, then it converges to some other expressions involving the CDF of a normal law. But when one computes A of L star, then this denominator cancels out with this term, and we obtain that something which does not depend on V, and this is equal to 0.234, whatever the choice of V. And this is the first magic number in this area of research, and this justifies to try to use a constant acceptance rate strategy with a target acceptance rates of approximately 1/4. Okay? But it is at least questionable to use some scaling results starting at equilibrium to deduce what should be done during the transient phase of the algorithm, of course, because what we need is to scale the transient phase. So, in fact, I recall the notion of chaoticity that was defined yesterday by Mireille to be able to state the main result. So we have a sequence of random vectors with growing dimension n, and these random vectors have exchangeable coordinates, so the law is invariant by permutation of the coordinates, and it's said to be new chaotic if, for each this k, the law of the k first coordinates as n goes to infinity tends to the k-fold product of nu, okay? And this is known to be equivalent to the law of large adverse, which is the convergence of in probability of the empirical measure, okay? This is in Snitzman's book. So my setting is the following white. I rewrite the evolution of my random walk Metropolis Hastings algorithm as follows. So the different coordinates, in fact, will interact through this common acceptance set, which is when uk plus 1 is smaller than the ratio of the densities, which is given here in this setting. And the main result is that if I assume that V has some regularity with bounded second and third order derivatives, and M is a probability measure on the real lines such that this fourth order moment of V prime is finite, then if the initial positions are exchangeable and M chaotic, and such that we have this limit, then there is propagation of chaos over time. Of course, we are working in the same diffusive scaling, time accelerated by the factor n. So what is the limit distribution? It is simply the law of the unique solution to this SDE nonlinear in the sense of Makin, which is also some example, a particular case of some example mentioned by Dan Krizan in his lecture yesterday morning. And what is the nonlinearity? It's given through two moments, the moments of V prime squared and the moments of V second. Okay? And I will next precise the function gamma on G. And we have also some convergence of the average acceptance probability to some other expression. Of course, the hypothesis is satisfied if the initial conditions are IID according to M, the hypothesis here. Well, what are gamma and G? Well, V is has a bounded second order derivative, and B corresponds to the moment of V second. So this will be bounded, so I have no concern about B. For A, it's the moment of B prime square. So this is some number between 0 and plus infinity. So I have also to define the function gamma when A is equal to plus infinity and when A is equal to 0. And it involves complicated expressions with the cumulative distribution function of the normal law. And the same for G. So when we take A equal to B or B equal to A, gamma of AA is equal to 2G of AA, and this simplifies, this is this very simple expression, or simpler expression, I would say. And in fact, when we start at equilibrium, of course, it's preserved by the Metropolis-Hastings algorithm, and it's preserved also in the scaling limit that I have done. So xt remains distributed according to this invariant density. And when I compute the moments of V prime square, then I can rewrite this as minus the derivative of e to the minus v, integrate by parts, and I obtain that it is simply the moment of this gond. Okay, so in this situation, we have A equal to B, and in fact, we recover the result by Roberts, Gell-Mann, and Gilkes. Okay, this is a particular case of our result. Now, what are the properties of gamma on G? They are non-negative, bounded from above. The function gamma is continuous and bounded from below by a positive constant. The function G is continuous, but at the origin. There is some discontinuity at the origin. And last, we have this kind of Euler Lipschitz type of regularity, where, in fact, to deal with the discontinuity at the origin, we have to introduce this multiplicative factor to obtain some regularity in the coefficients. Okay? And in the SDE, in fact, you see that you have the square root of gamma, the coefficient, and G. Of course, square root of gamma, gamma is bounded from below, so it has the biopositive constant, so it has the same regularity as gamma. And G, you see that it is multiplied by V prime. And in fact, this is some good news because V prime of xt is play the same role as the square root of A. And this way say that the two terms have the same regularity in some sense. And this way, by computing by Ito's formula, the differential of the square difference of two solutions, we are able to prove uniqueness for this SDE nonlinear in the sense of McKee. Now, I want just to give you some intuition why there is some mean field interaction behind this model. Okay, this is what appears in the exponential factor in the acceptance set, in fact, and I will perform some Taylor expansion up to third order, and the first and second order terms here give simply some normal distributions with mean given by the expectation of this Gond according to this empirical measure, and the variance is related to the expectation of the prime squared. Okay? And then this is the remainder. And in fact, from independence, we have that this product here has zero expectation. And in fact, it remains only terms which are diagonal of this form. And all the terms that come from the expansion of this one, but we have an extra 1 over square root of n here, so both contributions are of the same order, and we can check that this expectation of a square of a difference is bounded by some constant over n, so this means that the difference between the two expressions is simply of order 1 over square root of the number of components. Okay? So I may rewrite the Metropolis Hastings dynamics in the following way. I have only changed the acceptance set, in fact. So we have some normal, standard normal random variable gk plus 1 with these empirical measures, empirical means giving the standard deviation and the expectation. And so you see mean field interaction appearing. And we also have some covariance between gi k plus 1 and gk plus 1, which is given by this term. And to prove the theorem, one combines Gaussian calculations, diffusion approximation techniques, and propagation of chaos techniques. But this is a bit long, but not very difficult. Okay. So now I will try to go to practical counterparts. And the first is to understand the long time behavior of this SDE nonlinear in the sense of Makin. And so I give the SDE again, and the first result is that the density with e to the minus v is the unique invariant measure for the SDE, this SDE. Okay? What is clear is that it is invariant, of course, because before the scaling, when you start from this density for the initial conditions, it is preserved by the evolution by the Metropolis Hastings algorithm. So the unique point to check is uniqueness. So first, for uniqueness, you have that gamma is bounded from below. This ensures that any invariant measure should have density with respect to the Lebesgue measure. Then, when you get rid of the case A is equal to plus infinity by remarking that in this case G is equal to zero, so this does not lead to some invariant measure because you have just Brownian motion multiplied by some factor, so this cannot have some invariant distribution. And so A of psi infinity should be finite. Psi infinity will denote the invariant density. And B of psi infinity will be the moment of this Gond with respect to this invariant density. And then we have, again, by the calculation performed by Pierre de Gond yesterday, the expression of the invariant density. Okay? When we compute A of psi infinity by relating the derivative of psi infinity with psi infinity through this factor here, then we integrate by parts and we obtain some algebraic relation between A and B of psi infinity. And from this algebraic relation, which can be rewritten as the fact that this expression taken at A of psi infinity of B of psi infinity is zero, we end up that, with the fact that A should be equal to B because this expression is positive when A is different from B. So I have E to the minus V as the unique invariant density. And now the next question is, does the marginal law of the solution converge to this invariant density? And to check this, I go through the Fokker-Planck equation giving the evolution of density psi t at time t. Of course, A of psi t and B of psi t are the corresponding moments of this density. And when the first question is, do we have convergence of psi t to psi infinity? Or the second one is, we have still a free parameter, which is the multiplicative factor L in the denominator. And can we deduce the choice of this free parameter from the analysis of long time behavior of the density? Okay. So we will need some functional inequality to prove convergence. So some probability measure nu satisfies some log Sobolev inequality with constant rho if for any probability measure mu absolutely continuous with respect to nu, the relative entropy of mu with respect to nu, which is given by this formula and is called Kullback-Leibler divergence in statistics, is smaller than 1 over 2 rho times the Fisher of information of mu with respect to nu. And the Fisher information is simply this expression. So to satisfy some log Sobolev inequality, you need that the potential should roughly grow quadratically at infinity, in fact. Okay, so it is this remark here. And of course, in the Gaussian case, you have some log Sobolev inequality with constant rho equal to 1. So we assume that the initial density is such that this V prime square moment is finite and that the relative entropy with respect to e to the minus v is finite. And then our result is that the time derivative of the relative entropy is smaller than this coefficient. This is the positive coefficient that we used to prove uniqueness just before, times the Fisher information. Okay, and if one has some log Sobolev inequality, then we have some exponential rate of convergence. So which this is this rate lambda, which is a non-increasing function of the initial relative entropy. Okay? So how can we check something like that? So in fact, you compute the time derivative of the relative entropy, and we see this has some nice expression, and we end up with some non-positive term, which is that one that one always obtains even for linear dynamics, okay? And if a dynamics was linear, then it will be finished because, in fact, with the log Sobolev inequality, this is larger than the relative entropy and you have exponential decay by comparison, by a comparison result for ODEs. But we have some extra non-negative contributions linked to the non-linearity. And then it's always the same. You have to try many computations and you spend days trying to put things together until you find some trick to deal with such a term. And the trick is not so simple in the end, but still it takes time to find it. And this is the a minus b squared term here. Then I recall this is a is the moment of v prime squared, b is the moment of this gond. And in fact, one may rewrite it in the following way, integrate by parts. Oh no, no, I don't integrate by parts, I just recognize that this is the derivative of the log of this ratio times psi t. And now I can just do some Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, and this is smaller than a times the Fisher information that we already have. And we end up with this inequality that was taken in the theorem. And it's not totally finished because even if we suppose the log Sobolev inequality, because when a is going to infinity, this ratio vanishes. Okay, so we have to prevent a from going to infinity. But when we have a log Sobolev inequality, then we also have a transport inequality which relates the W2 Weishaupt-Chain distance to the relative entropy. And we already know that the relative entropy decreases. Okay, so we know that this W2 Weishaupt-Chain distance will not go to infinity, and this permits to control A, and then we obtain this rate of exponential convergence by taking this infimum over the A smaller than the upper bound for the coefficient A of a long time. Okay? So maybe I should end quickly. So I'm just going to summarize the last slide. We have this inequality, okay? And what we have done is to try to optimize over L this coefficient, in fact, to take this coefficient as large as possible. And it's possible to obtain several asymptotic regimes, L star of AB, when the ratio goes to zero is given like that. It's given by this expression when the ratio is equal to one, and to this expression when the ratio is going to plus infinity. Then we made some link with a constant acceptance rate strategy, in fact, okay? So we had some constant rate strategy choice of L given like this for the three asymptotic regimes that I considered first. And now we are able to relate the two regimes, in fact, the L star, or not the regimes, but the L star here and the constant acceptance rate strategy here. Okay? And this leads to alpha, which should be 1 over e for this limit, which should be 0.35 for the second choice, and 0.27 for the last regime. Okay. And so this means that constant acceptance rate strategy with alpha between 1/4 and 1/3 seem sensible. Well, I skip this, and I just go to the numerical example. This is just some Gaussian target. What's nice with the Gaussian target case is that the relative entropy has this simple expression in terms of the second order moment on the expectation. This is the second order moment, I guess. And this is the expectation. And one can derive, one can compute explicitly the derivative of the relative entropy and even optimize this derivative over L. And what has, we consider some ergodic means after some burn-in period T naught, okay, and capital T is fixed, and we are going to see the bias biases for both the expectation of the square, and this should decrease as a function of the burn-in period T naught. Okay, so this should be for the second order moment, for the first order moment. This is what is obtained with some constant L strategy with optimal L coming from Roberts, Gell-Mann, and Giggs. Next, we have the strategy leading to some acceptance rate equal to 0.727, either in an adaptive manner or in a non-adaptive manner. L star is the optimal choice of L, and L ant is the choice of L which minimizes this expression for the time derivative. Okay, and you see that everything performs in the same way; it should be close to zero, but the constant L strategy. So, if I now summarize, this is not a surprise. The constant L strategy is bad. Okay. Constant acceptance rate strategy are right strategy. Okay, they are almost as good as the optimal exponential rate of convergence strategy, and also the one given by the minimization of true derivative of the relative entropy. Okay. And of course, this confirms that what is done by practitioners, who know for a long time that they should choose or tune the algorithm so that the average acceptance rate is between 0.2 and 0.4. Okay? Thank you for your attention.